Hi, my name's Wade Price, and if I was an orc, I'd either be some kind of odd boy or some kind of mad boy. Today, I sat down with Citadel miniatures designer Matt Holland to talk about his background in sculpting miniatures and a special emphasis on the Tau Empire and orcs. Hi, Matt.
Hi.
Thank you very much for joining us.
Pleasure to be here.
So welcome to VoxCast, as you see on the screen, the official Warhammer 40,000 podcast. Going to talk about 40k for about an hour, if that's all right with you.
It is absolutely all right with me.
In your capacity as a Citadel miniatures designer, is that the correct of it?
That's true, yeah. I have been for about 10 years with Games Workshop now.
10 years. Yeah. That time flies.
Indeed, yeah.
And is that all as a miniatures designer?
Yeah, well, I've worked for Games Workshop for 20 years. But yeah, 10 as a miniatures designer.
So, tell us your story. What is the story of Matt Holland, please?
First got into Games Workshop figures, I guess I should say, when I was at school. I think another boy at school gave me a little goblin model, which unfortunately I don't still have. But I loved it at the time. Thought it was awesome. And I'd always liked board games and things like that. Got into... can't remember if it was Epic or Space Marine, tiny little figures mm-hmm. with some Titans, and it might have been the big robots that kind of hooked me. Played a few games of that, and around the same sort of time I got given Space Crusade for Christmas.
Yep.
And then I was fully hooked.
I think that's a lot of people's entryway or gateway.
Really, yeah, loved kind of everything about 40k. Obviously, the grim dark of the setting and everything. From there, I started to get more and more into 40k proper, if you like. I had Rogue Trader, but I couldn't understand the rules. But I enthusiastically tried to play some games of it. But it was second edition of 40k where I properly got into it and started playing games like on my living room floor with my mate who had come around.
I'm probably of a similar sort of age to yourself, and I certainly remember Rogue Trader being on the shelves when I first went into Games Workshop stores, but it was definitely second edition 40k that felt like it was written for someone like me to be able to understand it, because I was quite young at the time.
It was much more accessible. Yeah. You didn't need a degree in maths to turn a vehicle.
And cool card vehicles, and like the Orc Dreadnought with a little card standee until you could actually get round to pestering your parents for an Orc Dreadnought for Christmas.
Yeah. I always had a bit of a bug for changing my figures, making them look different to other people's, customizing and personalizing stuff, which led into converting, which led into scratch building. And then I would get to the point where I couldn't find pieces to scratch build something. So I was like, oh, I'll try and like sculpt it. I remember, I think one of the first things I ever sculpted, I wanted to do an orc war bike with a knob on it, but he required new legs for some reason. I sculpted them out of plasticine and put a layer of super glue over the top to protect the sculpt and painted it up. It was not as bad as it sounds.
Really, that worked.
That kind of works, okay.
Do you still ever use that technique now, or is it green stuff all the
time? Hobby wise I tend to use green stuff. It's much better for that kind of thing. And professionally I sculpt digitally now, so I just always wanted to have miniatures that look different from everybody else's, so it was lots of scratch building and converting. And then I started doing more and more sculpting and sculpting whole miniatures, but still kind of for hobby stuff.
Yeah.
And then one day I saw an advert for a trainee miniatures designer in White Dwarf, and a few different things clicked at that point, because I'd done some art and design at college and things like that, but I didn't know exactly what it was I wanted to do artistically. And something inside me went, I could probably do that. I could be a miniatures designer. Yeah. And a lot of hard work and practice later, and about 8 years of, just sculpting, I finally got taken on as a miniatures designer. I was working for Games Workshop from about 19. I worked in the store in Ipswich, and then I transferred to Warhammer World, and I worked there for a little bit. And then I got got my foot in the door in the studio as a mold maker, and then and then finally taken on as trainee miniature designer.
You must have got a lot of exposure once getting into Warhammer World, just even being in Warhammer World and on the site, to get a lot of exposure to
definitely
give you advice or
The team of Citadel Miniature Designers is amazing, and they've got so much experience. And yeah, I would regularly send emails to the studio, and when I first moved to Warhammer World, I was sending emails, and like Dave Thomas would come through and give me a hand, show me how to make stuff.
That's awesome.
Yeah, once you are actually working, like doing it all day, every day. So I went from sculpting for 3 or 4 hours every night to sculpting 9 to 5 every day with a team of highly experienced sculptors around me. And every time I get stuck, I can just stick my hand up and go, how do I do this? And someone will show you. So then your skills really kind of take off, and you can leverage all the experience of the team.
Do you ever remember seeing, was there anything in White Dwarf or anything at the time when you were first getting into the hobby? Do you ever remember what triggered the desire in you to make miniatures your own? Was there ever like, just, it doesn't have to be, I was just wondering if there was any kind of articles, is there just something in you that you couldn't deny?
Yeah, I think that, loads of stuff, I guess, like bits of everything. I think like maybe because our ranges used to be quite a lot smaller as well, so there'd be things that like there was rules for but no models for, so sometimes you'd have to like get a bit creative to be able to be like, oh, I want to play a game with that unit, but it doesn't exist, or that character. There was used to be lots of characters that we didn't do any models of, which was torturous for a lot of people, but I saw it as a challenge.
I think it's probably a bit of an even mix of people who were frustrated by that and people who thought, this is my time to shine. I can make a Gorgon or whatever it might have been for a book that didn't exist. I remember of the White Dwarfs of my youth, maybe we were probably of a similar sort of vintage. John Blanche used to do quite a few conversion articles, and John Blanche would collect a Chaos Warband or an Orc Freebooter Warband, and there were plenty of sawing this off and using putties that were available at the time. And that was, I remember that being something that opened my eyes to seeing the idea of conversions, but I never committed to making stuff out of blue tack and pasting it with super glue. I just bodged stuff together and tried to drill it.
Yeah.
And were there any factions in particular that drew your eye? Was there anything about the 41st millennium that you liked more than anything else at that stage?
I've collected orcs like since the very start, from like the, I think, was it the first plastic box set we did, Space Orc Raiders? Had that.
Plastic. Loved
that. I've always collected orcs. I've collected a few different armies throughout the years of my hobby, which have been lost to lofts and house moves and things along the way, but as they do. But orcs has always stuck with me, and later Tau was like a big thing. So yeah, those that know me know that I'm hugely into Tau.
Yes, I think we'll certainly come back to those and talk about, because they're big chunky topics. We can talk about your involvement with the orcs and the Tau. But on the kind of the Warhammer 40,000 theme, broadly, are there any qualities or hallmarks that you look for in Warhammer 40,000 Citadel miniatures, or any things that you look to put into your own work or look out for in others?
I think like because there's such a deep history and background to 40K and the gaming aspect as well, they both kind of often, one or both of those will be an inspiration to me for driving something forward. Like from my own personal hobby point of view, a lot of the time, as soon as someone says, oh, do you want to play a game next month, I suddenly go into overdrive. Oh yeah, but I need this guy to fill out that detachment, and then I can take three of these or whatever, and then I'm like busy making or painting something. So that's always fun. But sculpting wise, I think a lot of the time I draw inspiration like from the background, and there's so many brilliant stories of heroes or tragedies that I think there's just so much scope there for amazing characters to really kind of try to represent some of their awesome character and history and stuff when you sculpt the models.
I guess a lot of them are exemplars of an entire faction, really. They are, if you're just going to look at one miniature to tell you the story of a particular army, a lot of those special characters do that role. That Trajan Valoris, the Captain General of the Custodian Guard, that Adeptus Custodes release, that was a huge deal, because that was like a legitimately, they've been there for a while, but in terms of playable armies of the 40K game, that release was very exciting because no one had ever seen anything like that before. Mm. And that guy as the figurehead, as the named personage, but we'd never seen that kind of character before. So I guess you've made some models. I know you've worked on, you made the new Slime Arbo, mm-hmm. which was a classic character. So some of the characters you've made have been new presentations of classic and loved characters, and some characters would have never been before seen, and you've got a chance to create them and tell them anew. So yeah. There must be challenges for each. I won't ask you which one you prefer, because I've had enough of these conversations where people go, they're all great. I don't have a favourite. They're all great. So what are the, how are they different? Making someone up completely new or faithfully reimagining something?
I think, yeah, they both have definite things that you need to take into consideration. So if it's an existing character, I think it's boiling down what are the real key aspects of that character. I think so did Marnius Kalgar recently. Mm-hmm. And I felt like it was really important that he needs to look like Marnius Kalgar, like in the face. You know, I'm not going to drastically change his haircut or give him a beard or something out of nowhere. Like, I think you want to be able to immediately go, oh, I know who that is, mm-hmm. even though he's got a new suit of armor and he's maybe in a different pose to the other models you've seen. Should be pretty obvious that it's Marnius as soon as you look at it. And I've kind of felt the same way with Slime Arbos, like bits and bobs from the original model, which I wanted to incorporate, update, and then, you know, represent basically. Mm-hmm. But still, it's pretty obvious, hopefully, that it's Slime Arbo as soon as you look at him. Magnus the Red was like a huge project that I did. And yeah, like, whilst we had like a really old epic model of him, but we had lots and lots of artwork of him, and that was kind of the same thing, just drawing in, finding what are those most important key parts of like his personality that need to come across, like all the things that you might know and love from seeing all the artwork, and how do we represent those on the miniature.
The fact that he's got the choice of heads, I think that was a lovely touch, because Magnus the Red's story has been presented in different ways over the time. Mm. And as you say, that epic miniature, there was a tiny epic scale Magnus the Red who was a cyclops. He had one big eye.
Yeah.
And there had been older background that suggested he had been born as a mutant with one eye. But then there's other background that presented the Primarch as having both eyes, and he gave up one of his eyes for wisdom.
Mm.
And then you have all that represented in the miniature. So if you if you really remember that epic Magnus, and your vision of Magnus the Red is a giant with an eye in the middle of his forehead, away you go. But if you wanted to have him with his eye ripped out, you've got that touch in there as well.
Yeah.
And the choice of weapons as well. Like those kits, you must have a lot more frame space to play with it, isn't it?
Yeah, the space on the frame is part of our brief. So yeah, we have to kind of work within certain confines. But Magnus was in some respects unique in that I could make him as big as I wanted to within that briefed kind of playground, if you like. Mm-hmm. So as long as he fit on those frames, then we were good to go. So yeah, I made like a huge mock-up with that massive wingspan, and then kind of went, is this too big? And like most people were like, no, it's awesome, let's go with it. But I really like the idea that maybe, obviously, Magnus being a kind of right-hand man to Tzeentch himself, he has so much control over change. He can probably choose either how he appears or how you see him. Mm. And his weapon is a halberd and a staff and a sword and whatever else he wants it to be at any given moment, you know, if it even exists. Mm. It's kind of, and yeah, like maybe the different faces can represent his different kind of moods or what job he needs to be doing right now, or, you know, the different facets of his character kind of bleed through in his visage, which is really fun.
And that was the first Demon Primarch model, because that came out before Mortarion, didn't it? That was in the previous edition. So that really set the bar and set the expectation.
Yeah, that was terrifyingly challenging. I'd done some setup work on Thousand Suns, done some mock-ups for the sorcerers and some kind of sort of scaling exercises and proportions for what the Rubric Marine suit would look like, because we knew we were doing Primaris Marines at that point, but the Thousand Suns were going to come out first, so we didn't want the new Thousand Suns to immediately look kind of diminutive when the Primaris guys came out. So yeah, I did some of that work. And then Ben Jefferson, one of our design managers, showed me like a schedule thing, and Magnus and Red's on there, and I was like, are we actually making Magnus? And he was like, yeah. And I was like, can I make it? And he was like, yeah. But yeah, and then I immediately went, oh my God, this is really kind of a massive challenge. Like, yeah, it was kind of frightening to have to deliver the first plastic Primark, like something that, yeah, needed to be my best piece of work, definitely, and really live up to the kind of the weight of that character. But I was also, yeah, really kind of, I'm always up for a challenge, yeah. So.
Would it have been your, if you'd been given free reign of the Demon Primarchs or any Primarch to make, would it have been high on your list, do you think?
Absolutely, yeah, number one. Because, cool. So I'd worked on, I made the Thunderwolf Cavalry. Mm. And while I was making those, I listened to like Burning of Prospero and the other Horus Heresy audiobooks. Yeah. And I was kind of lightly aware of the rough story of Magnus, but then when it's fleshed out in those books, I was just like, it's the best story. Yeah. He's just such a epically tragic character. Mm-hmm. So yeah, I was well up for making him because I think he's awesome.
It is a great insight into the Chaos Space Marines, which some people might think, well, they're the bad guys, aren't they? And when you see the story through the seeds of the Heresy, there are definitely some bad people in the story of the Heresy, but Magnus is probably not objectively one of them. He's definitely on the wrong side of history. And yeah, you can see how it ended up the way it did for him.
Yeah.
But yeah, it is sad. There's loads of that in 40K as well. And just, that's part of the tapestry of the grim darkness of the far future, really, isn't it? There's not an awful lot of niceness there. Well, as someone who is one day hoping for an Angron miniature to be made, I'm very glad that the wingspan was as big as it was, because I think it's an important job to go, well, this is our first winged Primarch. I guess it was the first Primarch at all. It was before Reboot Gilliman came out. So yeah, you really need to set that bar so that nobody says, now make him a bit smaller. See if you can fit it into a smaller amount of frame space to do Primarchs in that regard. Statuesque beasts.
Yeah.
They definitely need to be of an appropriate stature.
Yeah.
Very good.
I was just going to say, the other part of your question was about creating characters that are completely new.
Yeah.
When you do that, I think you need to basically, rather than dig into the background and find out about that character, it's more about deciding who that character is and maybe picking up some kind of like archetypes for what kind of character that is. And I did Harkon Worldclaimer recently as well, so that's probably a good example of somebody who's brand new. And yeah, the brief for that guy was like a sort of Angel of Death, Herald of the Apocalypse kind of guy. So it was just picking away at like what those kind of dynamics are for that character. I wanted to make somebody who looks really aggressive and really like vanguard leader. So I knew I wanted to put loads of action and dynamic into him. And yeah, things like he's got like a kind of VoxCaster thing on his chest as well. I like the idea that he sort of broadcasts the word of Abaddon, and it probably comes out a bit louder through all his resonating chambers in his armor and stuff. So yeah, that was really fun.
I think in the background, Phil Kelly wrote up for him, it's all so hooked up then to all the Vox broadcasters throughout the city. So yeah, he patches into the network and lets the terrified inhabitants of the city know, Abaddon's coming, you're all going to die.
Yeah.
We should talk about orcs then, probably.
Yeah.
You have an affinity for the greenskins.
It's true.
So when did you first get a chance to actually design or sculpt any orcs miniatures?
I think it was... Oh no, hang on. Cast back my mind through the mists. When I was a trainee sculptor, I made a flash git.
Yes, I remember that guy.
With a targeting squig on his shoulder. And a big kind of shotgun looking thing.
And a bandana on his head.
Yeah, that's right. That was really fun. And yeah, spin forward. May or may not have made some other orcs in between that. And then... Yeah, the orc release that we did with the Gorkanaut and the flash gits and the big guns and stuff like that. I got involved with that at the beginning, did some mock-ups. So I mocked up like ideas for the Gorkanaut, the big guns, flash gits. We knew we wanted to do the mega armored knobs. They didn't really need the design for those, is awesome anyway. So it was pretty much make them in plastic with some cool new extra bits and bobs. And then Then I worked on the flash kits with some of the other designers. We were in a kind of transitioning from physical to digital sculpting kind of part. So me and Gaku were working physically, and Maxime Pastorel was in there on the computer doing some stuff as well. So there's lots of jiggery pokery going on. Mm-hmm. So yeah, that was really great to get in and sculpt them.
Do you ever work from sketches, or do your mock-ups tend to take just physical forms that you can show your ideas to people that way?
Yeah, I don't draw very well. Mm-hmm. I have always got a sketchbook next to my desk and I'm scribbling away at stuff. Sometimes I do little kind of like thumbnail type sketches just to try to get a few ideas shaped out. But I tend to find that I can be more expressive in 3D. So I used to do physical mock-ups, but now, just sort of blasting out shapes on screen is really good fun. When you can just rough something out and get an idea that you can communicate without having to worry too much about the details, it's always really fun.
How did you manage that transition from physical to digital? Did you, are you a big fan of the digital? Was it something that...
Yeah. It's funny because we used to joke, when we all sculpted physically, we used to joke like, oh, wouldn't it be great if we had a putty that, wasn't affected by gravity and was cured when you wanted to be, but wet when you wanted to sculpt it, and you could do this and do that. Or maybe if you had some kind of spray you could put on it to make it wet and you could sculpt, and then it could spray it again and it'd be dry and you could cut it. And digital is all of those things and more, basically. We can work in zero gravity and just throw something off, leave that there, that won't fall to bits. Whereas when you work with, because we used to make things three times the size as well.
Yeah.
And things want to fall to bits and you're blue tacking things together. Because, of course, we do all the, like, how the model is split into pieces is done by us as well. And sometimes you have to sculpt it in those bits, and other times you sculpt it kind of as one thing and then cut it up. It's much easier. And kind of all the donkey work, there's a lot less of that. So we can spend more time filling the frame with awesome stuff rather than sculpting the other side of a banner, whereas the computer can do some of those sorts of things, not for us exactly, but it can. There isn't a make Magnus the red button on the computer, but you can resize things and cut and paste and stuff. If you make a head in green stuff and it's a little bit too big, you have to just make it again.
Another head.
You've just wasted a couple of hours and you have to just start over. But obviously on the computer, you can just tweak it a little bit, which is really cool.
Oh, so let's say you get three heads for Magnus the Red. It's really easy. Just triple that, play with the eyes.
Yeah, copy and paste. They're all the same.
So what are your favourite things to work on with the orcs? What are your favourite things about the orcs miniatures?
I think I'm probably a bit of an orc at heart. So I like... all the big guns and powerful engines and clanking armoured walkers and stuff like that. I just love how kind of brutish they are and aggressive. Hopefully I'm not like that in real life. But I really like all that stuff. And I've always been really interested in like Speed Freaks type stuff. So in my own orc armies, I've always had loads of bikes and buggies and big battle wagons full of boys and stuff like that as well.
And for the different clans, like the six greater orc clans, we've not really fleshed out those ranges with different miniatures, but we know there are paint solutions and there's things that people can kitbash and convert. One of the things I'd like to do with these sorts of interviews, I think there'll be great scope for people, hobbyists out there, to get some insights. And if you were to make Death Skulls or Goth Orcs, if you were looking to kitbash or make some models, what kind of hallmarks of the greater clans would you be looking for if you were looking at other people's converted armies or a judge at the Best Orc Army Awards 2019, going through the greater clans, what do you think the features of them are and how could people capture those with their miniatures or their painting beyond the obvious?
I don't know.
That's fair enough. That's a fine thing.
Sorry.
That's
right. I don't know.
Because you worked on the Speed Freaks game and you had some involvement with designing the different vehicles, and we talked before about how they're not clan specific, but there were features in some of them that could nod to some of the clans, like the Rucker Truck Squig Buggy. When that got painted, I think everyone expected that's going to be painted up like a brown snake bite adjacent, if not a snake bite vehicle. It's probably got something in common with the snake bites. So are there features in those vehicles that speak to some of the traits of the orcs, maybe not the clans
Definitely. I think like, we wanted to try and pick away at maybe some other aspects of orc character. Mm-hmm. So yeah, there's a bit of, rather than evil sons, yeah, there's some like biker boy kind of stuff going on with the war track, and obviously fly boys being a kind of obviously fighter bomber pilots, and a little bit of storm boys, and you know, what kind of, what sort of things might they build or want built for them if they are getting involved in some racing. And yeah, like even more pure speed freak than an evil son might be in the sort of what's the buggy called? Snazwagon.
The Boondacker Snazwagon.
That one, yeah. I kind of like the idea that those are the orcs that other orcs call psycho. Like, they're really proper speed freaks. So yeah, it was really fun to like try and dig into some less clan specific stuff where we can play around with some other ideas, and that gave us the opportunity to give each one of those vehicles a really strong theme without saying you have to paint this Bad Moons. So you can still, if you collect Evil Sons, you can paint them all red and put them in your army if you want to, but they've still got bags of character, loads of cool stuff going on with them.
It reminds me of some of the background in the, you remember the Freebooters book for the first edition, and you had the bad orc bike boys who had been kicked out of their clan because they had too much affinity for the bikes. They weren't evil sons anymore or bad moons. They were a bad lot of bikers, and they were best left to congregate with others of their own kind and stay out of the clan and stop driving over the war boss's favourite grots and that sort of stuff. So it was nice to see bits of the old orc background coming back in, I think, in that sense, the same as in the Orc Codex, because over the successive iterations of the Orc Codex, maybe we hadn't had the space to put in some of those weirder bits of texture that have always existed in the older Orc background. When there were three huge books, you had War of the Orcs and Here We Go and Freebooters, which is hundreds and hundreds of pages probably to cover the entire Orc race as the model range covered it then. We've only added to the miniatures and the stories, and it's increasingly difficult to get all the great stuff into a book. And one of the things I know we worked on with the Orc Codex, or something that you're involved with, was updating the glyphs, because I think the Orc glyphs looked quite crudely drawn. They were angular enough, but they'd probably been drawn in the early 1990s and not really been updated that many times since then. I think they'd been kind of copied and put into a few codexes. And there was a great opportunity with Speed Freaks and the Orcs Codex. You gave us a load of lovely glyphs, you kind of hand-drawn, to show us how really the orcs would draw these symbols. It wouldn't just be a series of straight lines and triangles. There might be some curves or some notches taken out of them. And Joel Martin, who was the designer who made the Orc Codex, was very grateful for that, because we got to update the range of glyphs. But it was also to make them look like they were looking on the models at the time, because that's how the designers were sculpting.
Yeah, not all kind of... if you take it, like, you can have a really nice bit of graphic design that looks great at, sort of in 2D, but they don't always like actually sculpt onto models in 3D very well. So some of those things were kind of, let's have more of the stuff that we always put on the actual models, like into the sort of lexicon of orc glyphs, and update some, so then we could get even more. And that was good fun.
It's a fulsome looking spread, I think, for people who want to put some decoration on their orky vehicles. There's a great lot of stuff in that Orc Codex, like up-to-date glyphs, and other features of the orc miniatures range. Is there anything else that you get to do with the orcs that you just never get to do when you're designing other models, apart from, you know, big teeth and rusty bits of chopper?
Yeah, I think there's that really great kind of really dark humour with the orcs, which I think it's an important thing to try to find just the right tone. Like, I always explain it to people along the lines of, if you were there, it wouldn't be funny. It would be horrific and terrifying. But it's sort of gallows humour, third person. Like, it's kind of funny that, like, that grot is about to get fed into the gears on the back of the hot rod. It's not called a hot rod, is it?
The custom booster blaster,
thank
maybe?
Thank you. Yeah. all of those names have suddenly escaped me. that grot's about to get fed into the gears on the back of the custom booster and stuff like that. Like, it wouldn't be funny if you saw that happen in real life.
Certainly not if you're the grot. Like,
yeah. But, strong and tough is kind of my mantra for orc stuff. Yep. So, like, it's not funny because their vehicles fall to bits or anything like that, because they're all really solid and well-made. But then there is plenty of room for, like, some really horrific kind of brutal humour in there.
Yeah. I know that you you know far more about cars than I do. I can't drive. Like, full disclosure, I cannot drive a car, and I know that you like your cars, you like your engines.
Yeah.
Would it bother you to see someone like me taking a model that you might have designed, which looks like it looks like it's been designed to actually work, like you understand how all the different engines and the intakes work, and if I just orcify it a little bit by just stuffing different engines in or superfluous exhaust sticking out of places, does that make you twitch a little bit? Or
I think, like, we have to do a bit of that anyway, so it depends. Like, there's sort of rule of call, really. If it looks good, then you can forgive it. Like, yep. You know, yeah, you go, well, the exhaust doesn't come out of that bit of the engine, but if it looks good, then it's all fine, isn't it?
And that seems like how an orc would do it as well. Like, the orc mechanic or the guy paying the mech boy to fix up his speedster is going, just put an extra exhaust on it, make it more flashy. The mech might not really think it's going to do anything, but the orc might like it. And if the orc thinks it looks cool, then if the orc's the paying customer.
Indeed.
That's the most important thing to do.
Customer's always right.
The customer is always right, absolutely. Which is your favourite clan?
It's Evil Sons for me. Yeah.
Classic speed freaks.
Yeah. I like robots and cars and stuff like that. So, yeah, plenty of dreadnoughts and Gorkonaut in my army, and then lots of other vehicles to go along with it. So.
And does that translate into what you like sculpting? Do you like sculpting hard physical things rather than organic textures?
No. It's not that I don't like sculpting those things, but there's other members of the design team who are way better at it than me. I tend to do more anatomical stuff, monsters and orcs.
Yeah, and orcs.
That kind of thing. I was just going to launch into an example that was non-40k, which would probably be...
Yeah, I wouldn't understand the words you were using, I'm afraid. Not in this room, not on this day. I guess a lot of people know Brian Nelson, the involvement of Brian Nelson in defining the look of Warhammer orcs and orcs some years ago, probably towards the end of the 90s. That, hearing myself saying it out loud now, I remember now that's nearly 20 years ago. So there must have been other designers who've followed from the work Brian did in establishing that look of orcs towards the end of the 90s for Warhammer and for Warhammer 40,000. Are there other designers who have been more involved with orcs?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, Seb Perbe did loads of orc stuff. I think probably he picked up getting on. It must have been 10 or so years ago now before kind of... It's not like an official baton that gets handed over, but before it was sort of handed over to me, if you like. Mm-hmm. So Seb did like the Lutus and Burners. He worked on when we updated the Orc Boys kit. He did the War Boss for Black Reach and all that stuff. So yeah, Seb had like built on all the stuff that Brian had done, which was really awesome and had set that tone. And then he kind of took it to the next level. And hopefully, I'm like standing on their shoulders doing some more cool stuff, which people will like.
Absolutely. It's a great feature, I think, of all of those orc designs that they're all still so interchangeable that at no point along the design process has someone decided that the way the heads and necks fit together should be reversed. Like, you can still use Brian Nelson designed orc heads. I've been doing it on some snake points from the old orc greenskin boys for Warhammer Age of Sigmar. You can put them on the orc boys that were made, as you say, by Seb when he redesigned the orc boys kit for 40k. I've got a couple of them on some of the Speed Freak Buggy designs as well, because the neck design's still the same. That's, I think, in the same way as the Space Marines miniatures range for so long, has one of the hallmarks of the range has been how interchangeable they are.
Yeah.
You can put heads from Space Marines and Primaris Space Marines. They're interchangeable in the weapons. Jace Goodwin keeps making the point that the hands are the same size, the shoulders are the same size. You can mix and match elements of those ranges. And I think that's something that makes the Orc range so popular and so versatile, that there's still that commonality between so many aspects of the kit. Is that a conscious decision, or is it just easier that way?
I think... it's definitely something that we, in the past, has been a really conscious decision. Like, we'd want to make, definitely keep those fittings the same, build them off the same kind of, I want to say dolly, but that's kind of like an internal word that we use.
It's like the armature, isn't
it? Like, we have like set kind of armatures that we use for stuff. But sometimes that can be limiting, so we focus a lot more on, like, first and foremost, making sure the miniature is as cool as possible, and then if we can make the fittings the same, the neck fittings or the arm fittings the same across different kits so they can be interchangeable, then we'll absolutely do it. Like the flash kits are completely interchangeable with the orc knobs. Mm-hmm. But some of the Speed Freak stuff have got maybe some of the fittings are a bit more of a custom breakdown because the way the model's posed, it just wouldn't allow you to have that interchangeability. So we try to make sure that, yeah, first and foremost, the model looks as awesome as possible and don't let anything get in the way of that.
And I think I get the sense that people, hobbyists who have been through collecting through the 90s, when the kind of explosion of multi-part plastic kits started coming through in the 90s, there was a load of plastic kits and they were great and they were all kind of built around a similar format. You had a set of legs, probably a front and a back half of the body, the head went into the ball and socket joint in the neck, and you really could mix pieces from Warhammer 40,000 and Warhammer. I think the desire to make better Citadel miniatures, to make the Primaris Space Marines that we see in the poses that Intercessors are in, that the multi-part tactical squad could maybe never quite capture, I think there is some work to be done for people to just experiment with these kits, because I think in the 90s it was really easy to imagine I could put that Chaos Marauder head in a Space Marine body and that would fit. I think people just need to have a little bit more experience with cutting stuff up or seeing where the joins are.
Sometimes I'll try to get some interchangeability into a kit of infantry that I might make, but trying to show all of those options perhaps in the construction booklet is going to be really tricky. So it might tell you to build model A, B, C, D, but you might find if you start trying some of those pieces on different models that they actually fit and you can create some unique stuff.
So there's maybe some Easter eggs in the assembly guides. If you follow the instructions, you'll definitely make a model, but there might be other models out there that you...
I don't want to accept any responsibility for people ruining their models by sticking the wrong bits on there.
Okay, fair enough. Fine disclaimer. And orc vehicles, because I think there were some great archetypes that were represented. As you say, we've got the Megatrack scrap jet that looks like it's being piloted by a flyboy and it's got Wartrack engine on the back and plane engine on the front. Do you remember any of those older epic orc vehicles? Is there any, are there any old school classics that you'd love to be asked to make? Or
There was a time when White Dwarf would give you cardboard templates to build your own orc vehicles, wasn't there? Which I did build a couple. I think I built a Baneblade as well out of.
Yeah, that was Tony Coffell's Baneblade and hexagonal bases for the top of the sponsons, as I remember.
That's right. Yeah, there was a couple of those that I built. And I always had, like, a soft spot for some of the epic stuff, like the Mechboy Dragster and things like that. So, yeah, there's loads of cool things in there that we can, like, dig into again. That was one of the things when we did the big guns kit. I was really keen to get some of that old, like, the tractor cannon lifter dropper and stuff. They used to say, like, in the second edition codex, that one of the things that orcs were really good at was force field technology. And I think maybe we've almost forgotten that a little bit. Like, when they get a Space Hulk, they put a force field around it and load up all the boys and off they go.
It's what stops the boys from dying, really, isn't it? They've not, like, pressurised it or done anything. As long as the big green force bubble stays where it is in space, we'll probably be fine. And we've talked about orcs. We've talked about all sorts of Imperial things. We can talk about the Tau Empire as well, because that's another project that you've had some responsibility or involvement with. And they're very different to an awful lot of the forces of the 41st millennium. What do you like about the Tau, you weird alien sympathiser?
I quite like military stuff as well as cars. So the Tau have got a bit of a kind of near future high tech military thing going on, which I really like. If I hadn't mentioned it before, I quite like robots. There's definitely that aspect to it as well. Mech suits, robots, Titans, all that stuff. And I got involved when we did the release that was the Pathfinder's Riptide, the Bomber, and what else did we do for that one?
Cadre Fireblade, was that it?
Yeah, that's right, yeah. I hadn't long finished my training, and then, had another terrifyingly awesome challenge to try and live up to, where they asked me to do some mock-ups and concepts for the range. And yeah, obviously we had some existing stuff to work with, and Jez had put in the groundwork on a lot of it the first time round. So it was a chance to build on that, and had some great conversations with Jez. Like, if he had his time again, what would he do differently? What are the right things to build on, and the key like design points of it, and stuff like that. Oh, and the broadside, of course, we added in at that point in plastic. That was like an awesome opportunity to mock up those kits, and then I worked on the Pathfinders and worked with other members of the team while they made the other kits. Mm-hmm. Saying that, I didn't do all of the Pathfinders, like the drones and stuff. Ed did some work on that as well. It's just really awesome. Just like for the greater good, basically, collaborative effort where we all pull together for the Empire.
When you say, it's interesting that you started by saying you like military stuff, because I've always really taken to the Tau when in my job when I was planning codexes and stuff. When you look back at that very first Tau codex, it wasn't as big as some of the books that have come after, but it was crammed full of information, and that presentation of the team, the cadre, how their army is built. Mm. I think the people who were responsible for that first Tau codex were very smart people, they're geniuses, because it really did build in the understanding of how you collect these Citadel miniatures and arrange them on the battlefield.
Yeah.
It made that connection with the background and the futuristic presentation of their society. Mm. I thought it was really clean and really clear. And there's some of the other armies where I think, Tyranids, they do invade places, but we don't really break down what their military structure is, because it's more like a colony of creatures or insects. Orcs are a bit anarchic and anachronistic, and it's a bit of a warband as much as it is, but the Tau really do have that military society.
Yeah.
The Tau that you see are the military society of the Tau Empire in the main, and maybe a couple of Warcast ambassadors lying to you, and the Aircast pilots. But in terms of how that translates into the models that you buy, the way that you paint them, it's a really clean and a logical system. It's quite out of place in a lot of ways in the Imperium, because so much of it's built on superstition or outright madness, and the Tau have got a very a cleaner outlook.
And and it's kind of got some really interesting additional twists in there as well. Like there's a sort of martial arts kind of aspect to their warfare as well. So it's like high tech, super organized military stuff, but like the commander considers how he wages war an art form, which is really cool as well.
And meditates upon it before going into war.
And they're judged on like how well they perform the art of war and stuff like that. So I think that's really cool. I'm quite interested in that stuff as well. Mm. So yeah, I think all of that's really clever. Like those, there's sort of a little bit of a, almost like a samurai kind of influence in there, where samurai would consider ranged combat uncivilized, the Tau, it's switched around a little bit. And I think the Tau, they'll still kind of fight in close quarters, and there's a definite art form to that, like maneuvering for a kill shot at point blank range against someone with a sword is like definitely could be considered a martial art, I think. It's all of that stuff. I think it's really awesome.
Is it a bit of a palate cleanser against the grim darkness of the far future?
Yeah, and against the orcs as well, which I'm often thinking about. So, the clean lines and, everything being a bit more neat and tidy. I think the grim and the dark is still obviously there, but it's under the surface with the Tau. Mm. When I did the Pathfinders and later the Fire Warriors, I wanted to just try and get a little bit more like soldier on there, so they've got more equipment packs and general bits and bobs that you can dress up the models with to make them feel a little bit more like soldiers, and just it sort of adds a little bit more of a it helps them to fit in with 40k a bit better, I think.
Yeah, they're not completely unprotected, they're completely out of place.
And we started to paint them a little bit differently as well. They're a little bit dirtier and more chipped and worn now than when we first presented them, just to they kind of exist to as almost like a to show how grim and dark everyone else in the 41st millennium is, but they still need to live there.
They just don't wear other people's skulls or the skulls of their dearly departed friends and colleagues. Bonding knife ritual, that's a fine way of expressing familiarity and comradeship with people. You don't need to carry their skulls around.
No.
I know Jez Goodwin makes the point about the 41st millennium. A big feature that he sees and talks about in the 41st millennium is that juxtaposition of completely odd things that you wouldn't associate together. So he talks about the kind of antique weapons firing high-tech projectiles or high-tech ammunition, and that fusion of what you talk about with the Tau, the really high-tech, bleeding-edge technology combined with what we would see as, maybe historical or more medieval ways of being, or considering art, or considering war an art form. That's a lovely little juxtaposition, because they're not just futurist. It's not just pure futuristic space aliens or space robots. And also with the Tau, you don't have, I guess, with the orcs, and when we're talking about reimagining classic characters, there are some classic characters now. The Tau have been around. We've certainly understood Shadow Sun and Oshova. Mm-hmm. Got to get a sense of them. But there's more freedom to just make new stuff up for the Tau if somebody is of a mind to, and without giving anything away, because I've got no idea what you're working on at the moment. But that must be exciting as a designer to feel that you're trammelled by what people have seen before or might expect to see. You
can... Yeah, definitely. And there's always there's that little bit of fun that we can have with the Tau where the timeline in 40K doesn't really move on, or occasionally does, or creeps very slowly forward, but every time we do Tau, there's brand new prototypes and they've got this new type of weapon and battle suit, because obviously it really suits them to have like the latest gear and always be evolving their technology. So there's plenty of really fun places to play there.
It's fun working on those books as well, because I think like the Iridium battle suit that was first presented as, it's a prototype, one commander in your army can wear an Iridium battle suit, and now we have the Iridium upgrade that's in the XV8 Crisis box, and it would feel like a shame to go, yep, however many XV8 Crisis battle suits you buy, you can only ever use one of those. So now that prototype has been made more widely available.
Yeah, I really love that whole idea. Some of the first models that I made that actually got released were metal pathfinders with rail rifles. And when the background for the rail rifle was first written, it was hardwired into the head of the fire warrior or the pathfinder who was using it, and occasionally they'd get feedback and it would kill them, but we need to test these things, and this is the only way we can get it to work. And then when I did them as a plastic kit, the cable that goes from the gun to like his kind of body and plugs into him is missing because it's been refined and it's not a prototype anymore. And that whole idea of something being, I mean, it was the same thing I think with the cyclic iron blaster and the frag launcher. They were previously prototypes, but now you can have more of them in your army, so we kind of progress it on various different fronts, kind of in the background, on the miniatures and in the army books, which is really cool.
I think the Storm Surge has got more cyclic iron blasters that are on the Storm Surge.
He can have on his little defensive turret, he can have frag launchers, air bursting fragmentation launcher.
So you definitely have more on a single Storm Surge than you would have had in a previous edition of the code. Yep, we can make these safely now, and we can make Storm Surges, so kit them out. And that was an interesting development as well. Were you involved with the design of the KV-128 Storm Surge? Ballistic suit.
That was like the second Tau release that I worked on, and I kind of did the same thing again. I got in early and did some mock-ups and some concepts for both the Ghost Keel and the Storm Surge. I did little tiny half-size mock-ups because it would have taken too long to do really massive mock-ups. So we did some little half-size things, and then we could like take pictures of them and draw over them. And then, when Dale and Tom got hold of them, they like... really took them to the next level. Like some of the stuff on the Storm Surge, which wasn't present on my mock-up but came out in the design when Dale was working on it, was the idea that I knew that it shouldn't be a battle suit. I wanted it to be a different class of suit. So they have like a suite of different war suits, and they're not all just battle suits. And Dale incorporated some of the design language from the vehicles. So on the chest of like the Storm Surge, you'll see shapes and details that feel like they're part of the Devilfish or the Hammerhead, and bits and bobs like that all over the model. So it really ties. It feels like it's a conglomeration of vehicle and battlesuit technology to make a new platform.
Which the ballistic suit.
Yeah,
and that keeps the battlesuit imagery kind of exclusive to the commanders and reinforces that kind
absolutely.
Of samurai suit.
Yeah, because the battle suit is the hero's mantle, so it really should feel like a hero in his suit of armor doing dynamic, exciting things on the battlefield. Mm. Which is why, as well, the Storm Surge has that open crew compartment, so that you can see that it's crewed by a couple of guys, and they've got like lots of buttons to do, and they just sit in a seat with levers and screens, and they have to yell at each other and make. Probably has a beeping reverse noise and stuff like that, you know.
It'd be very loud.
But yeah, I quite like the idea that, yeah, like obviously that crew compartment would be protected with a force field or something, but if they're in close terrain, like a city or something, and they need to actually get up and have a look around them, they've got increased visibility that way.
And a bit of protection if they need to hunker down with a bit of shrapnel. Another feature of the Tau Empire, I guess, is that that great confederation of different races that they bring in. Mm. And when the Tau first launched, we saw the Kroot, the Kroot carnivores that came with them, and then the Vespid were one of the other races that had some miniatures. Is that an attractive feature of that army to you, if you had the... Are there bits of that wider empire that you'd be interested in exploring?
Yeah, definitely. Okay. Yeah, I think it is a really interesting and another kind of unique part of the Tau in 40k is they're a bit less xenophobic than the other races. As long as you join the Empire, it's all fine.
Yep.
I think there's a great bit of background where they like absorb one race into the Empire, but three generations later they all die out and the Tau inherit their homeworld. It's like, oh, this has happened. We had nothing to do with it, honest.
Definitely happened before.
But yeah, I think I absolutely love the crew, and I'd love to do some more stuff for that. It'd be interesting, to do more crew and Vespid stuff rather than just like pour loads and loads and loads more alien races in there. Mm. I think if you think about alien races that could supply the millions upon millions of troops across a galactic war zone, the Tau don't encounter loads of races like that, but the Vespid and the crew certainly have the numbers to. Yeah, those units, you'll see them popping up in lots of Tau armies, so it'd be great to do some more units and flesh those out a bit more. It'd be really fun.
I guess any other alien culture or race that did have a sizable military presence that might work with the Tau, the Imperium's probably contacted them at some point
or
in the previous 10,000 years.
Exactly.
And if the Imperium's contacted them, there might well not be any of them left.
Yeah, that's it.
Like the Kroot, it was interesting because, as I understand it, the story that I've been told was that the Kroot and the Tau were kind of developed originally around the same time, and the studio was looking at which of these races will we release, and released both and included the Kroot as a race within the Tau Empire. And then, as you said, you've been involved in two subsequent Tau Empire releases, the Riptide release and the Ghostkeel release. And I'm certainly happier as a customer, as a hobbyist, to have seen more Tau units developed and generated, because it is the Empire of the Tau. It's their race, their faction. You wouldn't want to see one new alien race dropped in to do something weird that the Tau could probably do themselves. They don't shy away from a fight. They've got the fire cast, the air cast. They've certainly got the means to do these things. There are, I guess it's a nice feature of the army that maybe advises, similarly to the Drakari, the way you've got the Court of the Archon. There's a Slith. There's an Urgul.
Yeah, there might be stories that we can tell on a smaller scale, like maybe Tau special ops teams always include a certain type of alien, but there isn't enough of them for them to be on every planet, on every war zone. Quite cool.
Are there any races out there that, or anything that's been associated with the Tau? Probably not the extinct. I think it was the Poktroon that died of some horrible disease that they weren't inoculated against. Is there anything that you've read about in the Tau background that... You do have a yen to work on?
I think it's been hinted that the Tau work with the Demiurge, hasn't it, before? So I think there's definitely some fun stuff to go with there.
It feels like with the Kill Team Rogue Trader box and the Blackstone Fortress box, Games Workshop's been kind of peeling away the corners of some of the older, gnarlier bits of background, and people are seeing some of this stuff for the first time. Some people are seeing it for the first time in 20 years maybe, and seeing miniatures of things like the Navigators and the Rattling Twins from the Blackstone Fortress that people have been very excited about. And I can imagine the same would be true of just anything that we haven't seen before. I think we're always excited to see newer, better versions. And going back to the beginning topic, talking about reimagining classic characters, everyone's always excited to see a new take on something they already like. But I think a lot of people are very invested in Warhammer 40,000, and we'd just like to hear more about it. And if there is scope to reveal the next bit of the story for the Tau, whether that's developing more prototype weapons or finding more Kroot or for more Kroot warriors or sending them into the war, that would be something that people would be interested in as well.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, and it's something that I really like to get my teeth into from a sculpting point of view as well.
So what personal hobby projects have you got on at the go?
I'm painting some orc bikes, and I'm putting together a new Tau Commander with lots of missile pods, because I thought that would be really fun. I have done a conversion of Commander Brightsword, for a while I've been doing a Viola and Enclaves Tau army, so it's kind of... red and white and white and red.
And very aggressive.
And quite aggressive, yeah. So, yeah, Command Bright Sword's awesome with, four fusion blasters just kind of drops in and kills anything that he looks at. But I wanted to do maybe my Viola commander, who I've had one for a long time, but he's like an older resin model. And I thought I'd just give him the updated suit. His name's Commander Skyfire, and I think it'd be cool if he's a little bit more of a hangback, fire missiles at anything that moves, and direct the troops and make sure that the art of war is being kind of conducted well. He's that kind of commander.
Nice. And is it just Orcs and Tau? Are you really that... not restricted, are you really that focused in the things that you're working on?
Yeah, usually. That's cool. Yeah, most paths lead me back that way.
The two different extremes of near future, hard-edged positivity for the Tau Empire and ramshackle crazy orkiness. Great stuff. What kind of advice would you have for anyone? You must have talked to a few people at games days, Warhammer Fests, events around the world. What kind of advice would you have for anyone who'd like to be a Citadel miniatures designer like you?
Probably don't be discouraged by how the first few models that you make look, because they're being pretty terrible. Mine were really, really terrible. Like, I don't show anyone at night. It takes a lot of practice. It's a real kind of skill to learn, and takes many, many hours of practice to kind of get good enough, basically. Get in touch with us. We kind of try to coach and help people and give them advice and feedback on their stuff. And I think probably the biggest thing for me was to stop sculpting for my hobby and focus on sculpting, because I really like sculpting. And then later on, you can go full circle and come back to it, So now when I go, oh, I want to convert this Orc War Boss, I'm converting an Orc War Boss as well, because I usually am. And I want the arm in this position and I can't find that bit. You go, oh, I'll just put a bit of wire in there and put some green stuff on it and sculpt an arm, because I can. So you can come back round full circle in the end, but concentrate on sculpting just for sculpting's sake, I would say, to get really good.
That sounds like a fine note to close on. Cool. I hope that will be of benefit to potentially a future generation of Citadel miniatures designers. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Hopefully we can talk to you again soon at some point when we have more Warhammer 40,000 stuff to talk about.
Great.
Cheers.